In chapter 1, verses 16 and 17, Paul, in those verses, he declares that he's not ashamed of the gospel of Christ because it's the power of God for salvation for everyone who believes, Jew and Gentile. So he makes that declaration in those verses. And then in chapter 1, verse 18, down through chapter 3, verse 20, he establishes the guilt of all humanity before God. This is the dire situation from which the gospel rescues mankind. So Paul spends a good deal of time nailing that down and establishing that. And then in chapter 3, verse 21 to 26, he declares his main point in that very theologically dense section of Scripture, that group of verses there. And his main point, which is that God's righteousness is available to all who respond in faith in Jesus Christ. All who are pronounced righteous, they are pronounced so as a gift given by God's grace through the redemption that was accomplished in Jesus Christ. And as I've said repeatedly, our innocence before God is something we are simply incapable of buying, incapable of purchasing. It is a gift that is given to us freely through His grace. And where we started last week in chapter 3, verse 27 to 31, Paul says the fact salvation is a gift of God that is received by faith, that removes any basis for boasting. You see, that takes away any basis for boasting as though our standing before God, our salvation, was achieved or earned or accomplished by something we did. Paul says that it takes away that basis of boasting. And then he hastens to add that this doesn't mean that Christians nullify the law. It doesn't mean that Christians deny that the law has any usefulness. On the contrary, though not being under the Mosaic law, and as I spent a good part of time last week explaining, that means not being under the set of commands that are part of the Mosaic covenant. Christians, though not being under that set of commands, they uphold the transcendent moral requirements that are included in that law. And so we are not lawless people. This is the law of Christ. This is what we do. It's centered in love, but it has objective content. And it encompasses these things like not envying and all of those kinds of things. So we uphold the law, Paul says in 3:27 or at the end there in 3:31. Then in chapter 4, verses 1 to 8, he explains how Abraham is consistent with his claim that salvation is by grace through faith for both Jew and Gentile, and that boasting before God is therefore excluded. He needs to incorporate Abraham into what he's saying because Abraham is the father of faith. He's a huge figure in Jewish theology. So Paul shows that Abraham is consistent with that. Even Abraham, who is a paragon of obedience. Abraham, the Jews looked at him as this just tremendously faithful obeyer of God. Even Abraham had righteousness credited or imputed to him by faith. Paul makes that point. See, Abraham was by faith given a righteousness that was not his inherently. It was credited to him. It was imputed to him. He was given that righteousness that was not his inherently. And then he ends 4:1-8 with the point that even King David confirms the truth of righteousness apart from works. And you see, he's writing to this congregation in Rome, the Christians in Rome, and you have Jews and Gentiles, and you see that Paul is showing, he's working to show that his gospel, how does it relate to these two? And this is a period of time when Jews and Gentiles in the relationship was, you know, it was being debated. You know, what is the right? So Paul wants to show his theology and his gospel so that when he goes there and then heads to Spain, that we'll all be on board and we'll all understand. So Paul is spending a lot of time in explaining these. In chapter 4, verses 9 to 12, he explains that Abraham shows that the blessing imputed righteousness, the forgiveness of sins, this is where we ended last week, that it's for the uncircumcised, it's for Gentiles, and it's also for the circumcised, for Jews. And he makes that point that Abraham's faith was credited to him as righteousness before he was circumcised. You see, so he stands then as the father of Gentile believers, those who have the faith of Abraham and therefore have the righteousness imputed to him as he did in uncircumcision. So he's the father of those. But Abraham was circumcised. So he then also serves as the father of Jewish Christians, Jewish believers, those who were circumcised and also share the faith of Abraham. So this is what Paul does in 4:9-12. Now let's pick back up with 4:13-22. No, 13-18. We'll do that first and then I'll pick up the last part. All right, 4:13-18. For the promise to Abraham or to his seed that he would be heir of the world was not through law, but through the righteousness of faith. For if those of the law are heirs, faith has been emptied and the promise has been nullified. For the law produces wrath. And where there is not law, neither is there transgression. Now, this is a parenthetical thing. Let me say something about that. Sin and transgression are different. There's clearly sin without law in the terms of articulated, express commandments. There is no transgression without law, without express commandments. And I use the idea many times of saying, you know when you're raising your child that your child knows things that they ought not be doing. Okay? They're still culpable and guilty when they do those things. That's a different order of disobedience than when you sit down and say, now listen to me. Do not go in the street. Do you hear me? Okay? You see, so this is the idea of law. Violating an express, articulated, given commandment is transgression. That's what he means when he says that there is, when there's not law, neither is there transgression. Okay, I'll talk about that more later, but that was a little footnote. Because when you see that, you go, what? So I wanted to raise that idea for you. Okay. He says, for this reason, namely that it may be according to grace, it is from faith so that the promise may be certain to all the seed, not only to the one of the law, but also to the one of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. Just as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. Then he picks back up, in the sight of God, in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls things not existing as existing. He believed against hope on the basis of hope, so that he became the father of many nations, according to what had been said, so shall your seed be. And without weakening in faith, he considered his own body, which had already died, being about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb. Yet he did not waver in unbelief with regard to the promise of God, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God and being fully persuaded that he is able to do what he has promised. Therefore, it was credited to him as righteousness. Now, Paul carries on here and he's continuing his point. And the reason that Paul, contrary to the standard Jewish view, made no mention of the law in tracing the spiritual descendants of Abraham is that the promise to Abraham, or his seed, his lineage, which Paul summarizes that promise as being heirs of the world. But the reason that Paul, unlike, you know, the standard Jewish view, he makes no mention of the law in tracing the spiritual descendants of Abraham, is because that promise, Paul says, was realized not through the Mosaic law, but through the righteousness of faith. So he doesn't appeal to that. That promise comes not through the Mosaic law. It's not realized through that, but through the righteousness of faith. I want to say something about this where he says, heir of the world. Now that to me is an interesting thing where he says, heir of the world. Now the land promise that was given to Abraham, you know, where he says Canaan's land. That land promise came to be seen in Judaism in the period of time between Paul and Abraham. It comes to be seen as symbolizing a broader promise of ultimately inheriting the world. And Paul here, he endorses that view. He says, look, that is the correct understanding, that the land promise carries with it a much bigger thing It is this idea of inheriting the world, and he sees the fulfillment of that promise in Christ and in everything that's been promised in him. So this idea of inheriting the world, the saints will receive the world as their inheritance, and they'll do so in the sense their destiny is what? Life in a redeemed creation. That is what we're going to have. We are going to have life in a redeemed creation, and Paul will talk about that when we get to Romans chapter 8. Let me read to you this quote from Severian of Gabala, and he was a bishop in Syria at the end of the 4th century. Colin Cruz cites this in his commentary. He says, Paul says that the righteous will inherit the world because the ungodly will be thrown out and handed over to punishment on the day of judgment. But the righteous will possess the universe which remains and will have been renewed, and the good things of heaven and earth will be theirs. You see, so this is what I think Paul is talking about here when he says that this promise to Abraham in seed form, which carries this larger view that we'll be heirs of the world. You see, it comes not through the law, but that promise is realized through faith. And so that's what Paul has been talking about. He says, look, if the inheritance was to be realized through the Mosaic law, then one would what? Believe in vain. Let's say we have great faith, but the inheritance comes through the Mosaic law. If that were the case, then one would believe in vain and the promise would never be fulfilled. Why? Because no one can obey the law adequately. You see, if the promise was hooked to that, well, then faith wouldn't count, because however much faith you have, the question is, are you going to obey this? And it would be nullified and wouldn't be of any value. Why? Because sin sits on people and none of them obey the law perfectly. And so Paul says, look, if that were the case, if that was how this went, then it would be in vain and it would never be fulfilled, because no sinful human being can adequately obey the law. See, rather than securing our inheritance, he says the law produces even more wrath. And that's the sense of the law converts sin to transgression. Both are culpable. Both are blameworthy. Both are punishable. But the giving of the law has the effect of converting sin into transgression, into the violation of this specific, express, don't go in the street. You see, so it actually aggravates the situation because of sin. And so it brings even more wrath. It turns sin into this more serious offense of transgression. And though Paul doesn't mention it here, he'll mention it later, it actually stimulated and provoked disobedience in the unregenerate heart. Okay, so Paul says, look, this doesn't come through the Mosaic law. Why is he doing it? Because he obviously is aware that there are Jewish Christians who are trying to put them together into one body, and they've got attitudes and things of how they're looking at these Gentile Christians and saying this. Now, the Gentile Christians have some attitudes too that Paul will address. But he wants them to see, listen, it is through faith in Jesus Christ that you are one body of believers. That's where your salvation lies. And so he wants them to see that. The inheritance is realized through the righteousness of faith rather than through the law, he says, so that it may be given as a matter of grace rather than as an obligation. If my standing before God is because I perform the law, if that's the case, well then, is what I get from God a matter of His grace, or is it a matter of something that He owes me because I earned it? You see, he says, no, it's not that way, because God functions in grace. He owes no man anything. And so he says, look, it's realized through the righteousness of faith rather than the law, so that it may be given as a matter of grace rather than as an obligation. Okay, so I mean, you can either earn something or you can have it given to you. Right? Now, you know the difference between that. You know, if you're doing something nice for somebody, you can just think of this way, that you serve a meal giving somebody something and they throw you some money for it. Well, they want to say, I want to nullify your kindness and your grace. I want to purchase it. Well, why? Well, you say, well, wait, I'm trying to give you something. No. I don't need you to give me anything. I will earn it. I will buy it. Okay, he says that's not how it is with God. You see, God gives to you graciously and you're not earning it. And that's why it comes this way. It comes through faith. It's being given as a matter of grace. That not only glorifies God who's obligated to no man, but it also ensures that the promise will come to fruition and that it will do so for every descendant of Abraham, Jew and Gentile, all of those who are of faith. That it will come to fruition for all of those, every descendant, for both Jews and Gentiles of faith. And that's what he says here. It says, the one of the law, he means Jewish believers. The one of the law, he means Jewish believers, and the one only of the faith of Abraham. That's what he means. That means Gentile believers. So you have those who are of the law and who believe. They are of the faith of Abraham, but they also are circumcised. They are also Jews. So it's for them. And it's also for those who have the faith of Abraham, but who are not Jews. And so it is by faith that they all may receive it. All of the descendants of Abraham may receive this, and it'll come to fruition. Abraham is the father of the faithful in all nations. He says, just as it is written, what? I have made you the father of many nations. So you and I are children of Abraham. Why is that? Is it because we're circumcised? We're Jews? No. It is because why? We trust the promise of what God has said in Jesus Christ, so we have the faith of Abraham. We are his faith descendant. What about the Jews who share that faith? Jews who are Christians, the apostles, the early church, what about all of them? Yes, they are children of Abraham because they are Jews, but that's not the pivotal part. They are Jews, but they share the faith of Abraham. And so that's what Paul is talking about. And he says, look, the God in whom Abraham believed, he's described here as he who gives life to the dead and calls things not existing as existing. God's giving of life to the dead. Well, you can see how that's pertinent to Abraham's situation, right? I mean, it's quite pertinent to Abraham's situation because in his body, what it says, had already died. Now, it doesn't mean he's dead. Literally, it means his body had died in the sense of its ability to naturally produce children. His body had died in that sense. It was no longer able, naturally, to produce children. So here we have this idea, he gives life to the dead. Why? Because Abraham, it says, his body, he had died. He was no longer able to produce children. It says, in Sarah's womb, he speaks of. You see, Abraham had died and Sarah's womb was dead. Okay, that same idea. Physically, naturally, they were not going to have children. It could not happen. They could not have children. They were dead in that sense. So God, who gives life to the dead. You see, so it's relevant and it's pertinent to what he's saying. And God's calling things not existing as existing. That's pertinent to Abraham's case in that God declared him what? I have made you the father of many nations. He's sitting there going, what? I have made you the father of many nations. That situation and that state did not yet exist. But God declared it. I call things not existing as existing. Now why? How can he do that? Because he's God. That's how he can do it. He says, I've made you. I'm looking around. You know what? No, I've made you. That's it. He's the one who can do it. He can control it. He can bring it about. Why? Because he's God. And so these things, when he says that, when he talks about who gives life to the dead and calls things not existing as existing, you see the relevance there to the situation and the promises that he's talking about. Abraham, he says, believed against hope in an attitude of hope. He believed against hope in an attitude of hope. He believed contrary to human hope or expectation. That's how, I mean, you know, when you hear the statement, somebody says, yeah, this person was rescued against all hope. Well, what's he talking about? They're talking about all was lost. There was no hope. From a human perspective or a human expectation, there was no hope. Well, this is what it's talking about here. You see, Abraham believed contrary to human hope or expectation, and with hope or expectation in God. He believed against hope on the basis of hope. He believed contrary to the lack of hope and human expectations, but he did it on the basis of his hope in God. So this is what Abraham does. From a human perspective, he had every reason to believe. Every reason to believe that he couldn't produce a child and to give up on the attempt to produce a child. He had every reason to do that, but despite the way things looked, he believed God. Despite how everything looked, he said, listen, I'm dead. No kids coming from me and no kids coming from you. It can't happen. There's just no way. It is impossible for that to happen. God said, I'm going to do it. He says, I believe. I believe that God will do what he said. Despite how things looked, he believed God, and thus he fully expected that his promise would be fulfilled. And this faith in God resulted in the fulfillment of the promise. He has indeed become what? The father of many nations. The father of the faithful throughout the world. Every Christian in every nation throughout the world, throughout history, looks to Abraham and says, we share your faith, Father Abraham. And so he's become the father of many nations. Just as God said, and he believed God when God told him, and he said, everything looks like that's impossible, but I believe you because you are God and you said it. And through that, the fulfillment was realized. Abraham, it says, didn't waver in unbelief with regard to the promise. Rather, his faith gained strength from its victory over the hindrance. His faith gained victory over the hindrance that was created by the conflict between God's promise and the physical evidence. God says, I'm going to do this. And you look around, you go, that can't happen. There's no way for that to happen. All right. So do you see that creates what? That creates hindrance or conflict. And it says here that his faith gained victory. His faith was strengthened. You say, well, how did that happen? It was strengthened from its victory over that hindrance that's created by that conflict. See, the more one believes despite the apparent impossibility, the more one believes in that situation, the more God is exalted as the one who is trusted to do the seemingly impossible. If God comes to me and says, listen, I'm going to do this, and I look around and I go, hold it, let me do some calculations on that. Yeah, you can't do that. That just won't work because I know physics. Yeah, you can't do that. Nothing can go faster than the speed of light. Okay, and a person says, look, and says, I know it looks a certain way. I know it looks like this is impossible, but because God has said that, I trust it. Well, who's glorified in that? You see, God is glorified. Why? Because you trusted Him to do the impossible. You trusted Him to do, if He said, I can do it and I'm going to do it, that's all I need. That's all I need. I don't care how all these other things look. I'm going to trust in God to do what He said. Now, Paul is here. He's apparently referring to Genesis chapter 17, verses 15 and following, where Abraham is told by God that Sarah will bear him a son. And I say he seems to be referring to that because he says Abraham is about 100 years old. And that's what he is in Genesis chapter 17. And he mentions that Abraham considered the condition of his and Sarah's bodies, which is precisely what he does in Genesis chapter 17, verse 17. So whatever you make of Abraham's laughing at the promise, you remember that? Whatever you make of Abraham's laughing at the promise and asking whether a son will be born to him and Sarah, Paul says that was not a case. That was not a case of wavering or doubting or being divided because of unbelief or disbelief or in unbelief or disbelief, whatever you make of it, that it wasn't a case of that, is what Paul tells us. Now, most commentators, they understand Genesis 17:17 to be an example of doubt on Abraham's part regarding God's promise when it says that he laughs to himself. You see, they consider this a case of doubt. And if that's correct, if that's the right understanding, well, then Paul in Romans chapter 4, verses 19 and 20, he means that despite the doubt that Abraham experienced, he never lapsed into unbelief, or he never abandoned his trust in the promise of God. So if that's the right reading, if that's really a laughter that's indicative of some degree of doubt, well, then Paul is saying, whatever that may be, he never lapsed into unbelief from that. Okay, but I'm not convinced that Abraham is doubting God's promise in Genesis chapter 17, verse 17. I'm really not. You see, it could be that he's laughing at the picture of him and Sarah as parents. In other words, he may not be laughing because he doubts that God can do such a thing, but he may be laughing at the thought of God actually doing it. I mean, you see, I'm 100 years old and I can just picture me with a baby. What, are you crazy? Right? I mean, you just like going like, man. You see, I mean, laughing in that sense, laughing in awe about God actually doing that. Like going, oh man, that's wild. That's my word. But that's the emotion that I'm trying to convey. Just kind of an idea of, man, something like that, you see. Well, God, you know, so in that light, you see, the questions are essentially that he asked then are questions of awe. Will God overcome even the impossibility of our age to provide this blessing? Wow. You see, they then, in that light, they then become questions of awe rather than doubt. Either way. See, either way, whether you take this with or without an initial passing doubt, Abraham faces squarely the impossibility of the promise. He faces squarely the impossibility of the promise, and he believes that God will do it anyway. And I think that's powerful. You see, that's powerful in the light of something that's telling you this cannot happen, for you to say, you see, if you and I work something out, we say, no, okay, I can see that. Yeah, I think I can do this, work that, do that. I think that. But how about when you look and you say, there's absolutely no way this can happen? And God says to you, I'm doing that. You trust him? Yeah. See, that's why I think, see, Abraham's faith is so powerful here. And I think, by the way, Sarah's laughter, on the other hand, that's rebuked. And I think that's because it was a laughter of doubt. And you see that in Genesis 18, verses 10 to 15. So at least that's my understanding of that. I don't think he's laughing in doubt. I think he's awed. But either way, you got to take what Paul says here. He faces squarely this fact of this impossibility. And then he trusts that God can do it. And that's believing. That's believing beyond. And I've told, I won't tell you again, a friend of mine who's suffered so much. And he just said, sometimes reason doesn't go far enough. You just have to trust God. You see, and that's the kind of thing here. Abraham's request regarding Ishmael, that need not be a reflection of doubt. You know, the promise that God gives Abraham, it's both amazing and humbling, and so humbling that Abraham says to God in Genesis 17, 18, that it would be enough if Ishmael could live under his blessing. So even that, I don't think you have to interpret that as a doubt. But as I say, if you take that route, then it's passing doubt. It never shakes his faith in the promise. And because he maintained his faith in God, it says here, it says at the end, therefore, it was credited to him as righteousness. I should have switched that slide earlier when I was talking, but I like to have it up there so you can at least make more sense out of what I'm saying. But okay, now in 422 or 423, is that right? 423 to 25. Well, 423 to 25, it says, but it was credited to him, was not written for his sake alone, but also for our sakes, to whom it is going to be credited. Those who believe on the one who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He was handed over because of our trespasses and was raised for the sake of the pronouncing of us righteous. Now I like this. You see, I like this here, the statement in Scripture that it was credited, imputed, given to Abraham as righteousness was also written for Christians. It was written for us. It was written for Christians. You see, for those who centuries later, millennia later, almost, it was written for those who years later would trust in God's promise in the gospel. See, which actually, you see, it fulfills God's promise to what? Bless the world through Abraham. See, he says, I'm going to bless the world through you. Here comes Jesus, the seed. And all the nations from all over the world then come and trust God's promise and express the faith of Abraham and become His children and are heirs all over the world. And He says, so this promise that it would be credited or imputed to you as righteousness was not for Abraham alone, but it was for all of us. Meaning what? Meaning as we in faith embrace Jesus Christ, what is given to us? Righteousness. Righteousness. Just as with Abraham, it was given. The God in whom we believe, Paul says, is the one who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. That happened, you know. Dead man, buried in the tomb, out, walking, feel me. And he says, the God who raised Jesus from the dead, the one we believe is the one who raised the Lord from the dead. And then he says that Jesus was handed over by God. As I've said before, it's not like we have this really, harsh. This is the picture that's often painted. We have this kind of negative and hostile father. And then we have the loving son. And the loving son eventually persuades the father. That's not how it is. God gave, the Father says, He gave Him over. He delivered Him over, as it says in Romans 3:25, to be crucified because of our sin, and He was raised for our justification. This was a Trinity project. All persons of the Godhead involved. And carrying on and doing what they had chosen from eternity, how they would accomplish this redemption. But you can't paint God the Father, saying, he's over here being persuaded. That's not it. Delivered over for our justification. Now, Paul puts it this way. I think it's interesting. He says, crucified for our sin and raised for the sake of our justification. And I think he puts it that way for rhetorical balance. He's crucified for our sin. He's raised for our justification. You see, so he puts it that way for rhetorical balance, and he doesn't intend to separate out our justification from Christ's death. He's not saying he's crucified for our sin, raised for our justification. That means he's not crucified for our justification. That's not what he's talking about. He's not doing that at all. You see, our justification was affected by both Christ's death and His resurrection. You see, these things, it is a unit. It was affected by both of them. You say, well, what is the relationship of His resurrection to our justification? Well, His death, you understand, His death is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. We know that. He dies as the atoning sacrifice for our sins. But His resurrection, it may be linked to our justification. Well, how is that tied to our justification? It may be tied to it in that it confirms what? It confirms that this atoning sacrifice is indeed the atoning sacrifice for sin. God marked it to say, that is what is going on here. In other words, He gave us a basis or strengthened the basis through which we would come to trust what that sacrifice was, that we might receive its benefit. So it can be connected that way. But it also can be connected in another way. You see, it may be that Christ's resurrection allowed him to complete the sacrificial rite. You see, it may be that it allowed him to complete the sacrificial rite by entering into the presence of God on our behalf. You know, according to the Old Testament, the high priest, he not only offered sacrifices, but he also sprinkled the blood on the altar in the most holy place. You see that in Leviticus chapter 16. So he makes the sacrifice, but then he goes into the most holy place and he sprinkles the blood. So you see something like that. You see Jesus, our great high priest, not only offering himself as a sacrifice by shedding his blood on the cross, but he also entered heaven itself once for all by his own blood and appeared for us in God's presence. You can see that in Hebrews chapter 6, Hebrews chapter 9, Hebrews chapter 10. So it may be both of those. In fact, Bob and I were talking about this after class one day. See, so this idea, it may be part of the rite. You say, well, then where do we cut the, what's the exact moment? It's a unit of things, you see. It's the whole thing that his death and resurrection, this is all part of what God has done for us. Okay, so I think either way you look at that, I don't want you to get hung up on this, say, well, he says here that we're, you know, he's crucified for our sins and he's raised for so that, you know, that's not his intent. As you can see when you read around other places and what Paul says. Okay, let me read to you Grant Osborne. So you see, we first 116, 17, 118 down through 320, where he makes the case and says, look, all are under sin. And then at 321 through 425, here's what Grant Osborne says about that in his commentary on Romans. He says, so Paul has now summed up his points. In 321 through 425, his doctrine of salvation by faith alone apart from works is complete. And we could argue about the faith alone part, as Scott and I were talking about the other day or a week ago. You know, somebody I like the line is that salvation is by faith alone, but the faith that saves is never alone. You see, so if you understand that, you cannot pull these things apart and say that by faith I simply mean no. That's never the case. Okay, but whatever quibble you might have with this, he says, 321 to 425, his doctrine of salvation by faith alone apart from works is complete. At the heart of his doctrine is the fact that Christ's death was a sacrifice of atonement, propitiation, what I call a wrath-averting sacrifice. You see? That's Christianity. That's why when people talk to me and say, well, you know, Christianity is about, well, it's just about ethics. You know, Jesus was a nice teacher and he went around and said good things. Love your neighbor as yourself and this kind of thing. I say, you don't know what Christianity is. Yes, he's a good teacher. I understand that. He's God. But Christianity, that's not Christianity. Christianity is here. It is the atoning death where God took on himself the punishment for our sin. That's Christianity. And there's nothing like it. There's nothing like it. He says, Christ's death was a sacrifice of atonement that paid the price for our sins, redemption, liberation through payment of a price, and resulted in God's legal decision to pronounce us right before him. Justification. The key is faith rather than observing the law. And this means that God is the God of the Gentiles as well as the Jews. You see, this is this idea of monotheism. That God receives, he saves in a way that receives and takes Gentiles and Jews in a way that honors and transcends their distinctives. Because he's the God of all people, Jews and Gentiles. To prove this, Paul turns to Abraham, the father of the nation and the one who precedes Moses, showing that faith has precedence over the law as a means by which one participates in salvation. Do you see how important this is for his getting the Jewish Christians and the Gentile Christians to get their mind right about the gospel of Jesus Christ? He wants them to understand how these things tie together theologically so they will come and say, all right, we're all with you and praise God for his gospel. So he's doing that. And that's why I've said before why I think his letter is so theological. Let me at least read this. I heard that first bell. They keep softening it on me. You see, I tell them to do that. And I say that I can say it on here. All right. Here's 5:1-11. We have a shift now, you see. We went 118 to 320, 321 to 425. Now Paul says, therefore, having been pronounced righteous from faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have had an introduction by faith into this grace in which we stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in afflictions, knowing that the affliction produces endurance, and the endurance proven character, and the proven character hope. And the hope will not put us to shame, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. For while we were still weak at that time, Christ died on behalf of the ungodly. For someone will scarcely die on behalf of a righteous man, though perhaps someone might even dare to die on behalf of a good man. But God demonstrates His own love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died on our behalf. Therefore, having now been pronounced righteous by His blood, even more shall we be saved through Him from the wrath. For if while being enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of His Son, even more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved by His life. And not only that, but also we boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Here's what Douglas Moo writes about this. He says, in this paragraph, Paul invites us to join with him in celebrating the marvelous benefits conferred upon the justified believer. The apostle speaks as, well, this is Martin Luther he quotes now, the apostle speaks as the one who is extremely happy and full of joy. And then he quotes a commentator, Leinhardt, he says, it is now the believer who's speaking, in fact, we might almost say, singing. And this is why, you know, we talk about, you know, I joke with people, how you doing? I'm doing great, I've been redeemed. You see, and we sometimes, it's just like, look, if nothing else, you know, I would love for you to come away from studying Romans with a sense of what God has done for me. Man! This is like amazing! Tremendous! I'm so thankful and so excited and praise you, God! And then we gather, you see, I heard that bell. We gather, you see, as a group of what? Redeemed people who all have this sense, we can't wait to get together. And what are we going to do? We're going to extol God with our voices. Father, we love you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. You see? So none of this when we gather together. No, we're just pouring out our hearts and spirits. And I frankly, if you can't sing, you think you can't sing and all that, brothers and sisters, praise God from your heart. Please get together and just praise Him, because this is our God. All right. Heard that bell. Thank you for coming.